أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Honorable, dear, respected brothers and elders, mothers and sisters, we always begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, sustainer, nourisher and provider. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us the opportunity to come to the masjid and to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we pray that this majlis be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may it be a means of guidance, inshallah, for our admittance into paradise, inshallah. My dear respected brothers and elders, we send abundant salawat and salam upon our beloved Nabi Kareem Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How fortunate are we to be part of the ummah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Congratulations, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, congratulations three times to the one who saw me and kept iman in me. And congratulations 73 times to the one who did not see me, but yet they kept iman in me, subhanallah. My dear respected brothers and elders, we know that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, throughout his lifetime, he went through major examination. And of the most difficult times that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faced was when he lost his beloved wife Khadija radiallahu anha. And as we know, Khadija was one of the foundations. She was a massive support for our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And many traditions mention the love and the special affection that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had for Khadija radiyallahu anha. In the very same year, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also lost another foundation, and that was his uncle Abu Talib. Abu Talib was also a great supporter of Islam, a great supporter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it was during this year that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lost a very beloved family member, and that is none other than his uncle. Another third sad tragedy that took place was the event of Ta'if. And as we know, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was instructed to go and invite people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet of Allah was confronted by very difficult times, pelted with stones, abused physically, mentally, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet of Allah, during his journey to Ta'if, it was so sad that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he returned home, and while his sandals were clotted in blood, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, on the bright side, we know as believers, one of the signs of Allah's love for an individual is when Allah ta'ala places that person through some type of trial and tribulation. Right? One of the signs of Allah's love. And of course, the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was who? Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For the Prophet of Allah, he was the greatest creation to roam the surface of the earth. We need to understand that. And of course, being the beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was tested. But as we know, as Allah says in Surah Al-Inshirah, إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ وَإِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَارْغَبْ. It is part of the trend of a believer that after difficulty will come ease. After hardship will come ease, subhanAllah. Just have sabr and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the road. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make things easy for you. And it was for these three incidents that took place in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that this year was known as عام الحزن, the year of sorrow. Being it the year of sorrow, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to gift our beloved Nabi Kareem Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the greatest gift. And that is a gift, my dear brothers. It is a great honor, subhanallah, how our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been honored with this majestic, this miracle gift. And that is the gift of Isra wal Mi'raj. My dear respected brothers, it is important to understand, as the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, being amongst the Sunnis, we must understand it is part of our aqeedah that we believe, and that's why it's important that we have these gatherings to explain the importance of how this is connected to our belief system, that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent in body and soul from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Jerusalem and to the seven heavens, in body and soul, in one night. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the concept of Isra wal Mi'raj in two places in the Quran. And in the first place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has named the entire surah as Suratul Isra in chapter 15, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Allah begins by praising himself. Subhana alladhi, glory be to Allah. That it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is the creator of the heavens and the earth. Allah can make that which is impossible in our eyes possible. So glory be to Allah. Subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi. The word Isra, it means to travel by night. It means to travel by night. So the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made Isra. Of who? Bi'abadihi, his slave. Referring to the greatest creation, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what we learn from this, the word abd means to worship, a slave. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testifying to the servitude of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the highest rank of iman. To be ibad of Allah, to be the true slave of Allah. Rather, we not use the word slave, but the one, as the scholars mentioned, the word abd, it refers here to the one who has perfected the concept of worship. There is no human on earth who has perfected worship greater than Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Many of us claim to be ibad of Allah. Sahih? Yes, I'm only but a slave. It's easy. It's easy to talk. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that I have sent my abd, this is the true abd. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أسرى بعبده ليلا, during the night, one night, من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. So what is important to note, the journey of Isra is from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Jerusalem. And Mi'raj means the ascension that took place. يعني something that is lifted up. So from Jerusalem right up until the seventh heaven. This is what we call Al-Mi'raj. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins this surah. الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed these lands. لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. That we show these amazing signs to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For it was during this journey that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was shown Ayatul Kubra, some of the most outstanding signs, subhanAllah. So where did it all begin? Where did this journey begin with our beloved Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam embarking on this miraculous journey of Isra wal Mi'raj? Now, to bear in mind, there are many hadith that speak about the topic of Isra wal Mi'raj. And inshallah, of course, the hadith which I mentioned to you today is from Bukhari Sharif. And unfortunately, you find many people who are the storytellers, they like to wish-wash the story and sometimes exaggerate. And it's important that when we study the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we study it from authentic sources, from Bukhari and Muslim and other authentic ahadith. Why? Because we're not speaking about any human being. We are speaking about the life of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we need to be precise. Hadith comes in Bukhari. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is laying in his house during the night. Jibreel comes down, and then the roof of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's house is then opened up. Subhanallah. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is then taken to the Hatim. Do you know what is the Hatim? The Hatim is between the Maqam Ibrahim. You can see a picture there. Between the Maqam Ibrahim and the Kaaba. So as we know, when Ibrahim alayhi salam, he built the Kaaba, it was not in a box form. It was in a rectangular form. It was, its original state is a rectangular form. So the question is, why is it today in the square form? So in the time, at that point, there was not enough funds to extend the Kaaba. So technically speaking, there is a barrier which we call the Hatim. So technically speaking, if you stand in that position, you are actually standing in the Kaaba itself. If you stand in that portion of the Kaaba, next to the Kaaba, in the Hatim, you are actually standing within the Kaaba. So Jibreel, he then brings the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to the Hatim. By the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his qudra, at that very point, Jibreel opens the chest of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he removes his heart. Two narrations mentioned, they are both authentic, that the Prophet of Allah, Jibreel, then washes his heart with Iman. Another narration mentions with Zamzam water. So what is the wisdom behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's heart being washed with Zamzam? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, during his lifetime, his heart was washed by Jibreel on two occasions. One occasion, when the Prophet of Allah was 4 years old, his chest was open and his heart was removed, and his heart was washed with Zamzam water, and a small black dot was removed. So what is the wisdom behind this process taking place for the second time? Ibn Hajar mentions the wisdom behind Jibreel removing his heart for the second time and washing it with Iman and with Zamzam is a preparation for what the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is about to see. Imagine, this is not a small journey. The Prophet of Allah is going to be exposed to certain overwhelming things. The Prophet of Allah, in order for his heart to bear what he is about to see of the Alimul Ghaib, of the unseen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing the Prophet by allowing Jibreel to extract his heart and to wash it with Zamzam and to place it back. And then Jibreel, what does he do? A beast, an animal, is brought to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, smaller than a mule, larger than a donkey, white in color. And its name is Buraq, from the word Barq, which means thunder. And this Buraq is also of the miracles. And it shows us the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It rides the speed of lightning. It rides for as long as his eyes can see. You know, when you are standing somewhere and you can see, so you can see miles away, imagine. This is how fast this beast gallops. And then Jibreel then orders the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to mount on this buraq. And this buraq becomes agitated. This buraq becomes agitated and overwhelmed. And then Jibreel, he then, you know how you have a horse, and the horse, it has a saddle. The buraq also had a saddle. And what we call it? A muzzle. What do you call it? The one that goes around your mouth?
Bridle.
A bridle. So the buraq also had a bridle over its face to control it, because it's an animal, but it's a very special animal. And then Jibreel, he then says to the buraq, because now he is, you know, he's neighing and trying to take the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam off his back. He says, do you not have shame, O buraq? Do you not know that you are about to accommodate the greatest creation on the surface of this earth, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So this journey that took place on earth, we have to understand this. The journey that took place between Makkatul Mukarramah and Jerusalem took place on this earth via the buraq. And of course, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was presented with many images. And of course, time does not permit me to go into finer detail. However, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he reaches Baytul Maqdis, Al-Buraq is tied by the animal post. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he then enters Baytul Maqdis, and what takes place there? Before, on the way, he passes by the grave of who? Nabi Musa alayhi salatu wasallam. And what does he see? He sees Nabi Musa alayhi salam qa'iman wa yusalli. He was standing and making salah. So in his grave, imagine. Now, bear in mind, my dear brothers, of course, we all know that the hukum of salah was not made compulsory as yet. But imagine you have a prophet who has passed away, Nabi Musa alayhi salam, and whilst in his grave, he is standing up and he is making salah. Subhanallah. That is the first time he met Musa alayhi salam. Then the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we need to understand that this is now the spiritual world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presented our Prophet with these images, with the reality. He met the prophets, he met the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam. There are two narrations. The first narration mentions the Prophet of Allah, he goes into the masjid and he performs two raka'ats. And when he makes salam, he then witnesses, he sees all the Anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam performing salah behind him. This is one opinion. The second opinion is that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he enters Baytul Maqdis and then he meets and he sees Musa alayhi salatu wasalam for the second time. And he mentions that Musa alayhi salam was very built and muscly, and he had dark skin. Musa alayhi salam, imagine, the one who spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he saw Isa alayhi salam, he met Jesus. And what were they doing? Musa alayhi salam, when the Prophet of Allah entered, they were standing and making salah. When he saw Isa alayhi salam, he was standing making salah. And then he saw Ibrahim alayhi salam, what were they doing? Standing and making salah. And the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what did he say? He says, I have not seen any prophet who resembled me, mirror image, than Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. So pretty much Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, they were like a spit image. Subhanallah. Then in this narration, the call for prayer is made and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam is instructed to lead the salah. Subhanallah. Now imagine this saf, there is only one saf. And you have over 125 prophets, anbiya, standing behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahu Akbar. And hence the reason, my dear brothers, from this hadith we learn that Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Imamul Anbiya wal Mursaleen. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was the Imam of all the prophets. Every prophet had a nation. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he led those prophets in salah, which makes our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the imam of all humans, of all believers that existed from the time of Nabi Adam alayhi musallatu wassalam to the very last Muslim to live on the surface of the earth. The Prophet of Allah, this is the status, this is the honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So from this very point, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is then taken up to the first heaven. Now, a very important point here, my dear respected brothers. He is then taken to the first sama. Now, many people, they get confused between the seven heavens. Many people think that the first heaven, second heaven, third heaven, these are all different levels of paradise. We need to understand and make one thing very clear. There is a difference between samawat and jannah. The seven heavens, there are seven platforms. And Jannah is situated on the seventh heaven. Jannah is situated on the seventh heaven. So there is a difference between Samawat and Jannah. It is not, this is the first level of Jannah, this is the second level of Jannah, this is the third level of Jannah. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with Jibra'il now embarks on what we call Mi'raj, the ascension. And he is taken to the first level. The doors of the sama open for Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then there is a gatekeeper. And this gatekeeper exists by every samawat, every level of every heaven. And they ask three questions. Who is there? Who is with you? And do you have permission? These are the three questions that the doorkeeper of the heavens pose Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and anyone who comes to the door. So imagine we are now dealing with the different samawat, the different earths, and they are strictly protected by gatekeepers. And it was through this journey of Mi'raj, and I will not go into too much detail, but just in a nutshell, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he then meets the various prophets. He meets Adam alayhi musallatu wasallam. He meets Nabi Yahya. He meets Isa alayhi salatu wasallam. And they are on various levels. Now many people spread the rumor that Nabi Adam, he has the lowest rank. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us in Surah Al-Baqarah, لا نفرق بين أحد منه. That we do not differentiate or distinct between the prophets. We can't say Nabi Adam is on the lowest level and Isa alayhi salam is on the highest level and Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam is on another level. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for them to be, and hence the reason why these samawat, they are not paradise. They are not paradise. It is just the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he has chosen for these various prophets to be stationed at these various stations. So the Prophet of Allah, he then meets these prophets and then he greets them by saying, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And then he receives the du'as of the prophets. And then he goes to the various heavens until he meets Ibrahim alayhi musallatu wassalam. And where is Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam? He is sitting back by the Bayt al-Ma'mur. The Bayt al-Ma'mur is situated directly above the Kaaba Sharif. So if something has to be thrown from Bayt al-Ma'mur, it will then land upon the physical Kaaba that we all know in Makkah al-Mukarramah. And Bayt al-Ma'mur, why has Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam been given this privilege of sitting by Bayt al-Ma'mur? Why? Who can tell me? Why has he been given the privilege of sitting by Bayt al-Ma'mur, which is situated directly above the Kaaba in the seventh heaven? Why? Because he built the Kaaba, subhanallah. Because Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam was the one who has been given the privilege to build the Kaaba Sharif. And as the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has mentioned, that the Bayt al-Ma'mur, Over 70,000 malaika, they visit once in their lifetime the Bayt al-Ma'mur. So a malaika, now do the math. In 10 days, 70,000. How many? Huh? 700,000. Subhanallah. In 10 days, 1 million. 1 million malaika, they enter the Bayt al-Ma'mur in 10 days. My dear respected brothers and elders, it was through this very miraculous journey of Isra wal-Mi'raj where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was presented with the gift of salah. And that is why the Prophet of Allah says, As-salatu mi'raj al-mu'min. The most important thing we must understand of believers is the importance of this journey that took place, that we believe as part of our aqeedah, we believe that the Prophet of Allah, he embarked on this journey in body and soul from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Jerusalem and to the seven heavens to receive this gift of salah. With every other hukum, it was sent to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam via revelation. But regarding salah, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he received this gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this miraculous journey. Which brings to our intention a very important point, my dear brothers. How important our salah is. And as we know, salah will be the first question that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pose to us on the day of Qiyamah. And as we know, my dear brothers, there is more to the story. There are many scenes that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was presented to. But unfortunately, I do not have enough time. And inshallah, I will speak about this during the Jumu'ah khutbah this Friday, inshallah. However, my dear brothers, the lesson that we should always take home is how important is my salah. A day cannot go by, wallah, without me fulfilling my obligation as a Muslim to perform my daily salah, my 5 times daily salah. We need to understand that through this blessed night of Isra wal-Mi'raj, Allah has blessed us with this gift of salah. This was a gift bestowed upon our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but in reality, this is a gift to the believers. This is a gift to the people of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. My dear brothers and sisters, the salah of a believer is the foundation. What differentiates us between the disbelievers is our salah. As-salatu imaduddin. Man aqamaha faqad aqamaddin. Wa man hadamaha faqad hadamaddin. Salah is the foundation of Islam. Whoever performs his salah, he establishes Islam, the deen of Islam. And whoever abandons his salah, he has actually abandoned Islam. This is the reality. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, salah to a believer is like fish in water. Can a fish live out of water? Can a fish survive out of water? It will die, my dear brothers. Likewise, salah to a believer is like fish in water. It is alive. And when a person does not perform his salah, automatically he becomes a dead person, subhanAllah. My dear respected brothers and elders, I end off. We all know the current situation about what's happening around the world. Every day we shed tears about what is happening to our brothers and sisters around the world. Allah gave me the privilege to go and see firsthand in Jordan and in Turkey the situation of our ummah. How children are eating grass. How many people have lost their mothers and fathers, subhanAllah. 4.5 million of our Muslim brothers and sisters have been forced out of their homes. People who once upon a time had businesses, who had wealth, today they are living in tents 2 meters by 2 meters. Let us not forget our brothers and sisters of Gaza. La ilaha illallah. It's so overwhelming. We see videos every single day, subhanAllah. Hospitals being bombed. I was in the city of Kilis on my trip, subhanAllah. And then ISIS decides to throw a bomb. ISIS decides to throw a bomb. And over 8 people were killed. And just yesterday we received, they just threw down another 3 to 4 bombs in that very same town of Kilis. And that is the border between Turkey and Syria, where people are doing good work, where we have bakeries, where we provide aid to our Syrian refugees. Imagine, you have these people trying to bomb our Muslim brothers and sisters in Turkey. La ilaha illallah. Somalia, the drought that is taking place in Somalia. What about Burma, subhanallah, the Rohingyans? They are going through a tough time. People are being burnt alive. Why? Because they are Muslim. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, our ummah is suffering. Our ummah is suffering. And through the blessings of Salah and Isra wal Mi'raj, through the gift of Salah, we have a tool. We have a tool. But unfortunately, we are not utilizing this tool enough. And that is our Salah. Allah Ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. O people of Iman, seek assistance with salah and patience. Verily Allah is with those who persevere. My dear brothers, how many of us have gone up, gotten up, disturbed our sleep for the sake of Allah, and performed salatu tahajjud and cried in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our brothers and sisters who are suffering, who are being slaughtered, women being raped, people being urinated upon, people eating grass? How many of us have disturbed our sleep for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make dua for our brothers and sisters? We are Muslim. And when we take on this amana of being a Muslim, we need to remember that we are not alone. We are not alone. The body of a Muslim ummah is one body, my dear brothers and elders. It is one body. Who cares about the media? We always complain. We spend more time complaining than making dua. Dua is thrown out the window. When last did we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When last did we disturb our sleep? How many of us every day make dua for our brothers and sisters who are suffering? We are all guilty of this. We hear about it, it goes from one ear out the other ear, my dear brothers. Allah has blessed us with this tool. We have the direct connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By Allah, our salah, our dua is far much powerful than media. Sahih? Do we believe in our salah? Do we truly believe in our dua, our salah? They can come with the top media in the world, but wallahi, we will always have the upper hand for as long as we have iman. We make dua and we make salah. And inshallah, when everyone unites making dua, when everyone unites in disturbing their sleep for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, we will see change. Inshallah, we will see change. So my dear respected brothers and elders, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the understanding, the tawfiq to make dua, the tawfiq to disturb our sleep inshallah, us and our families, wake up your wives inshallah, make wudu, make 2 raka'ats of tahajjud, and in sujood cry in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi, my dear brothers, if we complain in this dunya, in this country, we are very ungrateful. Wallahi, we don't have problems. Reality, we don't have problems. The people in Syria, the people in Gaza, in Somalia, in Burma, the people in Iraq, they have problems. They have problems. And the least we can do, my dear brothers, is support in whatever way possible and make dua for them, inshallah ta'ala.